September 11th, 2001 remains the indelible moment of this century. Everyone remembers where they were on that fateful morning as the national attention turned to New York, Washington, and Western Pennsylvania. Everyone wondering, what does America do next? Only a select few were involved in figuring that out, and we are privileged to have one of those people here in studio. Andy Card, Chief of Staff to President George W. Bush from 2001 to 2006. Mr. Card, Andy, thank you so much for joining us.
Adam, it's a thrill to be with you, and thank you for allowing me to reflect on that day that we all promised we'd never forget.
So you had to deliver some of the most important news that anyone has ever delivered to an American president there in Florida, and as the second plane after it hit the World Trade Center. Take us back to that moment. What was that like as you entered into that room and had to deliver that message?
I'm going to back up a little further than that. We woke up on September 11th after having come in the night of September 10th to Sarasota, Florida. We came from Jacksonville, Florida. Before that, we'd been in Washington, D.C. But I remember arriving on the 10th when the doors to the limousine were opened up and the president and the entourage got out of the motorcade and went into a hotel. That there was a terrible stench in the air. The red tide had killed fish. They'd washed up on the beach. We were in Sarasota, Florida. And I just remember being struck by that terrible stench. We dropped our luggage off into the Colony Resort, which was a tennis and golf resort, and then piled back into limousines and went out to dinner in Tampa, Florida. And it was not a working dinner for the president, so he was having dinner with a number of friends, and it was kind of a fun night, and he stayed out later than normal. And when we got back to the hotel, we went up, went to bed. I got up very early on September 11th, 2001. I remember going outside to check on the advance team and the motorcade and the Secret Service, and things looked appropriate. I talked with the advance folks in the Secret Service about what we were going to do. And then I went in to greet the president, and he was getting up and getting ready to go for a run on the golf course. And he was putting on his running clothes, and he was preoccupied with this run because he invited a reporter to go running with him. His name was Richard Dick Stretch Kyle, and the president found out that he had been an All-American cross-country runner. So he was paranoid that he shouldn't have invited this guy to go running with him. The Bushes are all very competitive. I like to say they don't even let the grandkids beat them at checkers, that type of thing. And I knew the president was going to go out for this run. I had already checked with the doctor and said, is the red tide going to be something that I should worry about if the president goes out for a strenuous run on the golf course? And the doctor said, no, he'll be fine.
You didn't want him to feel sick, essentially.
Didn't want him to get sick.
Yeah.
And chiefs of staff worry about all those things.
Yeah.
And so the president is getting ready to go for the run, very preoccupied that Stretch Kyle is going running with him. And he said, I don't know why I invited this guy to go running. I didn't know he was a cross-country runner. And I went and did some work. He came back from the run. He beat Stretch Kyle, so he was cocky and kind of got the George W. Bush strut. He ran 720 miles for 4.5 miles, so he was pretty well engaged and excited. And I said, I remember saying to him, it's going to be an easy day. You're talking about your favorite topic, which is leaving no child behind in education and education reform. Should be an easy day. And he said, great. And he went off and got dressed. We came back. We had a briefing from the CIA about the intelligence, overnight intelligence, which he got every day. And I don't remember anything from that briefing that would cause me concern. It was a pretty standard briefing. And then as we were piling into limousines to go over to the Emma E. Booker Elementary School for him to sit in a classroom with second graders and read a book, I remember as we were climbing into the limousine, there were some questions being raised. Karl Rove and Dan Bartlett said, anybody hear about a plane crash in New York City? We arrived at the school. The president went to a secure phone and called the National Security Advisor, Condoleezza Rice, back in Washington, D.C. I did not listen to that conversation. I went into the classroom where the president was going to go to see if it was being set up the right way. So I checked it all out, saw the students lined up. They were on their best behavior. The teacher was with them, and they were getting ready to walk into the classroom. I saw Ari Fleischer, the press secretary, huddled with reporters in the press pool. They were not in their best behavior, but that was pretty typical. And then I checked the classroom out, and then I walked into this room that had been a command center for the president. And I'm standing with the president and the principal of the school at the door to the classroom where the president is going to enter. When the National Security Advisor for the trip, a Navy captain by the name of Deb Lauer, came up to the president and said, "Sir, it appears a small twin-engine prop plane crashed to one of the towers at the World Trade Center in New York City." I remember the president, the principal, and I all had the same reaction. "Oh, what a horrible accident. The pilot must have had a heart attack or something." And the principal then opened the door to the classroom, and she and the president walked into the classroom. The door shut, and I am standing there, and Captain Lauer comes up to me and says, "Sir, it appears it was not a small twin-engine prop plane. It was a commercial jetliner." My mind flashed to the fear that the passengers on the plane must have had. They must have known they weren't gaining altitude. I don't know why that's where my mind went, but that's where it went. But that was only a nanosecond, because Captain Bauer came up to me and said, "Oh my God, another plane hit the other tower." And it was then that I performed a task the chiefs of staff have to perform all the time. Does the president need to know? Easy answer to that question, yes. What do I tell him? I decide to pass on two facts, make one editorial comment, and to do nothing to invite a dialogue or a question from the president. I knew that he was sitting in front of second graders, in front of a press pool, and I assumed there was a boom microphone that would be able to pick up whatever was said. I thought about what I would say, and I will admit that I did think of three initials, UBL, Osama bin Laden. I knew about the attacks on the World Trade Center in 1993, and I knew about Al-Qaeda. So, yes, I had that knowledge in my mind. I thought about what I would say. I decided to pass on these two facts, make one editorial comment, do nothing to invite a dialogue, opened the door to the classroom, I stepped in, and I remember the teacher was conducting a dialogue between the students and the president. Say good morning to the president. "Good morning, Mr. President." This dialogue back and forth. I didn't want to interrupt it. The president did not see me coming in. I came into the room from behind him. Ann Compton with ABC News was in the press pool, and she gestured to me, and I gestured back to her, "Two planes." Mm-hmm. And she gestured back to me, "What?" Then the teacher told the students to take out their books, and when they were reaching down under their chairs, that's when I walked into the classroom, and I walked up to the president, leaned over. He never turned to me. He did kind of nod one direction. I leaned over and I said, "A second plane hit the second tower. America is under attack." That was all I said to him. I stood back from him so he couldn't ask me a question. When I stood back, I could see his head bobbing up and down. He never turned all around to me. I was very pleased with how he reacted. He did nothing to introduce fear to those kids. He did nothing to demonstrate fear to the media that would have translated it to the satisfaction of the terrorists. But I was also impressed that he was thinking about his job. I believe that's the moment he became president of the United States. Mm-hmm. He took the oath of office January 20th at noontime, 2001. But I think that moment when I said America was under attack, he recognized his obligation to keep his oath to preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution.
As you're sweeping out of that school towards Air Force One, I think, you know, here we are 20 years later, you know, we know what unfolded. But in that moment, I think United Flight 93 is still in the air. So as Air Force One is taking off, you guys have to figure out where you're going.
Well, first of all, the president made some remarks to people in a gymnasium, and I was upset when the first thing he said was, "I'm going back to Washington, D.C. And I'm thinking, he doesn't know that we're going back to Washington, D.C. He just said that something was happening and he had to deal with it, and he was going to deal with it. He left Secretary Rod Page, the Secretary of Education, in charge. And then the president and I were in the limousine driving to Air Force One to leave. I had already asked the pilot to get the plane ready to leave, the Secret Service to get ready to leave, so that was in motion. As we're in the limousine driving to the airport at a very high speed, the president is frustrated because he's calling back to the Pentagon to reach Secretary Rumsfeld, and he's frustrated that he can't get through. I'm talking to people in the White House. That's when we find out that the Pentagon had been attacked. So we had the first attack, the second attack, the third attack on the Pentagon. We're in a limousine driving to Air Force One. The president is frustrated. We get to the airport. The door to the limousine is opened up. The president steps out. The engines on Air Force One are already running, which is a protocol no-no. So I say, Mark Tillman, the pilot of Air Force One, must really want to get out of here. So we get on the plane. We're rolling down the runway almost before the door is shut on the plane. And the president takes his seat. We take our seat. We get up in the air. And then Flight 93 didn't happen until a little bit later when we were on the plane and the president is making phone calls. He called President Putin, for example. He called to check on his wife, and he checked with all the people back in Washington, D.C. But he also received a call from the Vice President of the United States asking if the military had permission to shoot down commercial jetliners if they were not responding to the FAA communication to land. And I remember when the president authorized, yes, our pilots could shoot down commercial jetliners, I believe that Dick Cheney had already given that order, but anyway, that's another story. The president, I was impressed, hung up the phone and he leans across and talks to me. I'm sitting at the desk in the office on Air Force One. And he said, I can't believe I just delivered that order. I was an Air National Guard pilot. I can't imagine receiving that order. I was very impressed that he had great empathy for the challenge that he had just authorized. It was soon after that that we learned Flight 93 had crashed into the ground in Shanksville, Pennsylvania. And yes, some of us on Air Force One wondered if it was shot down by one of our pilots. It turns out it was not. The first heroes in the war on terror were the passengers, the civilians on Flight 93. They were the first heroes in the war on terror when they said, let's roll. And rather than have Flight 93 be flown into the Capitol or the White House in Washington, D.C., it crashed into the grounds in Shanksville, Pennsylvania. And I encourage people to go see that memorial. It's very moving.
Mm-hmm. In some ways, it's, you know, a part of the tragedy, but can get overshadowed by what happened in New York and Washington. I'm curious, you know, thus begins this whirlwind of response. And of course, the president going to New York City and that bullhorn moment and all that. When did you, though, feel like you got your feet back underneath you, where you were like, okay, you know, we know what's going on and we're going to proceed?
Well, I was very focused that day. As I was standing at the door of the classroom, I did reflect on another time when I was the acting chief of staff on a trip for another president, George H.W. Bush, when he went to Japan and threw up on the Japanese prime minister. And the world thought the president was dying. And I remember thinking, I'm going to do everything by the book because there's probably going to be an investigation and I'm going to do it right. So I was cool, calm, and collected on that day in Tokyo, Japan, with George H.W. Bush. And with George W. Bush, I reflected on that and I said, I'm going to be a source of calm, objective advice for the president and make sure I help him make very, very tough decisions. So I was completely focused on helping him. And I remember when the day ended and we arrived back in Washington, D.C., and he spoke to the American people from the Oval Office. Then we had a national security meeting down in the bowels of the White House, in the bunker underneath the White House. And then the president went up to bed. I went back to my office. A Secret Service agent came in and yanked me out of my chair, ran through the west wing of the White House, took me down to the bunker. A plane was entering D.C.'s airspace without identifying itself. I'm in the bunker. Down comes the first lady. Down comes the president. They're carrying their pets. They go to a room. We're there. The Secret Service has shut the door, and we don't know what's going on. And Secret Service agent says a plane had entered the airspace over D.C., not identifying itself. We are staying there. About 15 minutes, 20 minutes later, we get the all clear, and everybody was told they could go to bed. I then went back to my office, collected my stuff, and went home. By then, it was 11:30, 12 o'clock at night. And I will admit, I was still wound up, had not talked to my wife the entire day. And so I really didn't relax or decompress at all. Was in the office by 5:30 the next morning and tried to focus on the present. It wasn't until after September 14th, 2001, and September 14th was my most memorable day at the White House. That's when he went to New York City and he went to the National Cathedral and he had his meetings. It was then that I was able to, I say, get to the point where I felt I had a routine, a normal routine. Before that, we were really trying to deal with how do you see through the fog of war and how do you understand the nature of the attack? Are there others coming? What is the response? How do we search and survive? And what do we do to get ready for whatever we have to do to rebuild the confidence in this country and the allies around the world that are necessary? So it was a very dramatic time. I don't want young people today to forget the emotions of that day that they didn't get to experience because they weren't alive then. But, you know, there were 10 people from New Hampshire that woke up on the morning of September 11th and drove down to Logan Airport. And five of them got on American Airlines Flight 11, five of them got on United Airlines Flight 124, and they took off, and those planes were used to attack the World Trade Center towers. So it impacted people in New Hampshire. And those 11 people that died just because they went to the Logan Airport to get on a plane to fly to Los Angeles. And that was just, you know, those were 11 people out of almost 3,000 that died that day. And we can never forget what happened.
Yeah, and, you know, certainly this, we were just talking about this before we started recording the segment, the idea that there are young people who are, you know, of voting age now, over the age of 18, who have no memory of 9/11 happening. It's stunning to think about something like that. But when you reflect on the legacy of that day and all the country has been through since, what do you think about? What is that legacy of 9/11?
Well, when George H.W. Bush was elected, there was a great divide, a political divide in the country. He was elected president basically by the Supreme Court, so it was a very controversial election. The nation was divided. September 11th, 2001, had the situation where America became united. All of the divisions that were part of politics and part of the natural debate in this country had disappeared, and we were united together. We all rallied to help. In fact, the world rallied. We had a remarkable coalition of countries all around the world that said, we are standing with America, standing against terrorism. So that's the lesson that I think we can see. Good leadership in times of trouble can bring us together. Right now, the United States is very divided. We have a pandemic going on. We should take the lessons of 9/11 and see how can we demonstrate that we can come together today the way we did after the terrible attacks on September 11, 2001. So that's where the people who are weren't even born on 9/11, they're only entering voting age right now, that's what they can do. Go back and take a look at 9/11 and see how did we unite. What caused us to say, we're standing together, we are Americans first. We're not Republicans or Democrats first, we're Americans. We're standing together, and that's what we should be doing.
What about the threat that was realized so terribly on 9/11? Obviously, Osama bin Laden is dead. Al-Qaeda as an organization is not necessarily as functional as it once was. But the idea that became, you know, fighting this war on terror, which is nebulous, right? That there's no necessary victory because terror can be perpetrated by generations. So in terms of that response, you know, where does America stand now in being able to, you know, have a kind of safety that I think was, for a lot of people, fractured? That idea on 9/11, 2001 was lost, and maybe we've never gotten it again.
In the aftermath of 9/11, America did a lot to shore up its own safety. And we new institutions. The TSA did not exist before 9/11. The Department of Homeland Security hadn't been created. Having your luggage screen, standing in lines, wasn't a reality. You could just go down to the airport and get on a plane, and you could go greet someone as they get off a plane. Today, you can't do that. So a lot of things were put in place. Thankfully, America has been quite safe from terrorist attacks since 9/11. So great credit to the leadership of the Bush administration and all the presidents that followed him to make sure that we keep America safe. And it is now imperative that we recognize that many of our institutions actually changed their missions because of 9/11. The FBI, their mission used to be to investigate and prosecute. Now their mission is to prevent the next attack. And thankfully, the United States and our infrastructure of military and intelligence and FBI, Justice Department, the Homeland Security Department, the TSA, are all doing their job. And we haven't had, knock on wood, another attack, a terrorist attack. Other nations have. But the war on terror is not over. It will go on almost for eternity. That's why we have to be nimble. And that's why we have to respect those who do answer the call to duty and invite young people to consider answering the call to duty to help protect America.
All right. Andy Card, former White House Chief of Staff, thank you so much for sharing your stories and recollections.
I should have a shout out to the folks in Omaha, Nebraska.
That's right.
You know, Nebraska played a big role for us on September 11, 2001. The president went to the Strategic Air Command in Omaha, Nebraska, and that was where he got to hear the fog of war, because he went down to a bunker deep underground and saw the admirals and the generals that were there helping to make sure the military had a good response. But you could hear all the communications in the FAA, planes coming in, and they were doing a remarkable job. It's where the president had a chance to digest the obligations that he had, have communications back to his team in Washington, D.C. and around the world from a very secure facility, and then have the confidence to be able to go back to Washington, D.C., where he could help lead us through this great tragedy that we had experienced. So the people in Omaha, Nebraska, thank you, and the people of New Hampshire that helped to make a difference in democracy by showing up. There's more participation in our republic from the people of New Hampshire in how they participate in their government than any state in the union. That's why I'm proud to be a New Hampshire resident.
All right. We'll just I'll jump into the specific questions that KETV has here on the Offutt stuff. What were your thoughts as you landed at Offutt Air Force Base, knowing you were basically threatened like everyone else, but specifically a target because of the president, knowing that you were headed to that secure bunker?
Well, when we left Sarasota Air Force Base, or the airfield in Sarasota, we didn't know where to go. I met with the military aides, Tom Gould and Paul Montana, on the flight, and I said, I need some options. I want a nice long runway, B-52 capable runway. I wanted to be 45 minutes to an hour away from where we were, and they gave me the option of Offutt Air Force Base in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. I'm sorry, Offutt's in Nebraska. We went to, I can't even think of the name of the base now.
You guys went to Louisiana first then?
Went to Louisiana first. We then trimmed down the number of people on Air Force One, and I said, where's the best place to go with the best communication? And it was the Strategic Air Command in Offutt Air Force Base in Nebraska. So we went to Offutt, and they whisked us right from the plane right down to an underground bunker, and that's where we had phenomenal communications. But yes, we had protection. Fighter jets had caught up to Air Force One, and they were accompanying us on the flight to Offutt, and then they accompanied us from Offutt back to Washington, D.C. I remember as we landed in Washington, D.C., the fighter jets were so close to Air Force One, it was coming to land at Andrews Air Force Base, that you could literally see the faces of the pilots in those planes, and they did a great job of protecting us. But Offutt was, it was known that we would have good communications, the best communications probably in the nation, to be able to deal with the challenges, and the president could get the information he needed and decide what to do next. And when we were in Offutt that he decided to go back to Washington, D.C. He had been pining to go there all day long. We didn't want to go there until we knew it was safe, until we knew we had the capacity for him to be able to meet his responsibilities as commander-in-chief with good communication. So that's why we went to Offutt.
Yeah, what was the president's demeanor like? It seems like, as you're saying, he was really raring to go back to Washington.
He was very anxious to get back to Washington. He and I had an argument on Air Force One. He kept telling me we were going back to Washington. He said, I don't think you want to make that decision yet until we know it's safe. But he was very disciplined that day. He was decisive in his decision making, but he was also not emotional. He was cool, calm, and collected. He was actually very attentive to not just what he needed to do to protect America, but what he needed to do to make sure bad actors didn't do bad things and try to take advantage of the crisis that was taking place. So that's why I brought up the phone call to President Putin was very important. He said, this is what's happening here. Don't think we're using this to attack Russia. Don't you do anything stupid that will cause us not to be focused on preventing the next terrorist attack. Yeah. So he worked very closely with other leaders around the world to make sure that we had a good coalition of support when we did enter what became a war on terror.
It's interesting. The non-state actors started all the problems on this day, but you had to deal with the big state actors there to make sure everything was frozen in place. Were you ever personally afraid?
I was not afraid on September 11, 2001. Number one, I knew I was with the president, who was going to be protected by a remarkable service called the Secret Service, and they are very responsible in times of danger, and they were meeting that responsibility very well. The same thing with regard to the pilot of Air Force One. He was very calm and steady and made sure the plane was safe and that all the passengers were safe. So I did not feel threatened. I will admit I was a little concerned about my wife, who I love, who was the minister of a church right near the CIA in McLean, Virginia. And I had some thought that maybe the CIA could be a target. So I did worry about my wife, but I did not have any fear that day. And I was very grateful for the protection that I saw others give the president as he was meeting his responsibility. I had confidence in our government. And
obviously, America responded in a variety of different ways, most notably going into Afghanistan and then in the invasion of Iraq. Obviously, the impetus for the war in Iraq was the weapons of mass destruction. Was there regret or any personal disappointment when those were not found?
I was surprised that we did not find hard evidence of Saddam Hussein having the means to weapons of mass destruction. He had already used weapons of mass destruction on his own people. We knew that he had the capacity to do it, and intelligence certainly did suggest that he had either the means to reconstitute weapons of mass destruction very quickly or use them. I was surprised when we did not find them. That was not the only reason we went to war. And by the way, the president gave Saddam Hussein many, many chances to live up to the commitments made to the United Nations. There were 16 commitments made to the United Nations. Saddam Hussein did not comply with any of those commitments, and there had to be some consequences. But the war on terror was primarily focused in Afghanistan. There were other places all around the world. Remember, bad things were happening because of terrorists, not just in the United States, but also happened in Spain, in Italy, in France, and in Great Britain. And so there was a real network of support in the intelligence communities from all of those nations. And I remember some of those intelligence reports from other nations also suggested that Saddam Hussein had the means to use weapons of mass destruction and would probably do it. But he had a chance to comply. He didn't. There were a lot of lessons learned by going into Afghanistan, a lot of lessons learned by going into Iraq. Hopefully, we've learned our lessons and will not make mistakes the way that they were made before, and recognize that there are always unintended consequences, and you've got to have a plan to deal with them as well.
Is the country now where you thought it would be in terms of continued vigilance in protecting security, not just of the country, but of the people?
I'm very impressed with the nature of commitment at the Department of Homeland Security, the CIA, the FBI, the Defense Intelligence Agencies, and the TSA about trying to keep us safe. I think America gets the highest marks in the world for being able to demonstrate today that they protect America from external terrorist threats. I think we'd have an increased number of internal threats from entities that like to disrupt our economy or disrupt our government. And I worry about that. But I have great confidence in the institutions, and I think they are better today than they were before 9/11. And we've learned valuable lessons. But it's always going to take a commitment of the people. And that's why we want to be partners in government rather than see government as a hostile entity. The government is ours. We, the people. The most important word in the Constitution is the first word, we. It's our government. Get engaged. New Hampshire is a state where people do get engaged with their government. I wish more states recognized how New Hampshire does their job, and we'd be better as a nation.
All right. Andy Card, former White House Chief of Staff, thank you so much for sharing your recollections of that fateful day.
Thank you.